All right, let's turn to Galatians chapter 1. We're going to continue talking about the heart of the Father in relationship to the eternal plan. That's the best title we've said yet. The heart of the Father in relationship to the eternal plan. We know, and we've studied multiple times in the past about God's plan concerning his son, and that plan involved obtaining a bride after his kind and in his image. But in this study, we've been talking about the angle from the Father's side, from his viewpoint. We've been taking the time to show in the scriptures the many facets and examples of the Father's desire, and the Father's desire for sons in the image of Christ. And as we've often said, that is male or female, but it is after the Son. It is in the image of the Son. It is his spirit. And hopefully we'll see that tonight. We saw that in relationship to Jesus wanting a bride. It had nothing to do with gender. It had everything to do with a certain heart toward Jesus. So we're doing that in relationship to the Father. And what I want to do at the beginning of this class is to, for some of you possibly, maybe awaken you to scriptures that we've always applied to the Son, but they apply to the Father, and what really comes to the Father by the Son, but is also our response. So in Galatians chapter 1, let's look at the very end of verse 4. According to the will of God and our Father, and then verse 5, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Okay, so there is this desire of the Son and of those who are after his image, who have been conformed to the image of the Son. When that Son begins to be formed in us, and this is all in Galatians chapter 4, which is all in this book, but we're not going to go there quite yet. When the Son is formed in us, there is a response out of us. And it's literally an inward bursting forth of the Spirit of his Son in our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. The word Abba represents a intimate word for Father. That's not just father or dad or whatever, but it's more intimate than that. And so this, you know, this verse is basically talking about that there would be glory, to whom be glory forever and ever, according to the will of God and our Father. And I've told you before, but the word and many times can also be translated even. According to God, even our Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. So I want to just take you through three verses. Turn with me to Ephesians chapter 3, and we want to look at just two verses there. Ephesians 3, verse 20 and verse 21. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. And that, remember that the other one in Galatians was, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. To Jesus, this is the amen. This is the so be it. This is what he wants. This is what he wants for his Father. This is his goal. And these words here are interesting because I think most of us probably take now unto him and we immediately think unto Jesus. Now unto him that is able to do, yes, Jesus can do this. Unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we ask or think according to the power that works in us. Unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus. All right. Well, that shoots down quite a bit right there, doesn't it? We're always trying to do it by the church, to give Jesus glory by the church instead of the Father the glory in the church, inside of, by Christ Jesus. See? And it's different. But here's the thing that I'd really like to communicate is there's a different spirit working there. There's a different reality that should have us, the reality that should have us, not that we have it, but that it has us to such a degree that when we search the scriptures or when we are about the Father's business by Christ, which we call ministry, there should be a certain spirit, a certain agenda that's flowing, and that is that the Father would get glory by the church, but really the church is made up of many members, and that's his body also, the church which is his body, it says in Ephesians, but not just the church that is in buildings, but the church which is his body, and it is that he's getting glory, the Father is getting glory, not Jesus, the Father is getting glory in the church by Christ, and that would mean that the agenda of the heart of the Son toward the Father is at work in us. That we're in conjunction with that, that we're in agreement with that, that we're God, his body. You know, and we're letting him do what he wants to do, but the Father's getting not just glory in a certain sense, he's getting glory in the church. But it's by Christ Jesus. And we have to never forget that the Son is the only Son that's ever going to really do that, but he's in us. Okay, so every Christian says, I have the Son in me. Do you have Jesus in you? I do. Is he the Son of God? Yes, he is. But what we're just saying is, we're saying, in that sense, we're saying it's Jesus that is within us, but he happens to be the Son of God. A minor addendum or addition to that is that he's the Son of God. I have Jesus in me. And what does that mean, you know, if I may say it like that, what does that mean toward heaven, meaning the Father? What does that mean toward heaven? It means that, we're going to be saved or something. It goes off on something that is all about us, and Jesus exists for all about us, but Jesus is the Son of God. And his heart's desire is that the Father would get glory in the church, but he knows that it's by him, so he must be in us, the Son of the Father, melting, because the bride, look at the bride. She's not just, well, I'm the bride, okay, nice to meet you, you know, what do you need? Not that, it's not that kind of spirit. So, well, why would this be that kind of spirit? And it wouldn't be, because the heart of the Son to see the Father, to get why he invested in this creation in the first place, why he wanted it to come to pass. Okay, now we can clearly understand the nature of the Godhead. We can clearly understand the nature of Father towards Son, and Son towards Father, and Spirit towards Son, and you know that movement that goes on all the time between them, and the flow that flows so many different directions. We can understand that, But we must understand it in a true context of being. Their being. Their existence. Their reality has to be. You know, if we're not even aware of their reality, then we're just fitting God into our reality. I mean, that's it. We're just living our little Christian lives down on this earth going, well, this is what's important, and you know it's important. We have a Bible school. You know, I'm going to tell you something. Maybe I never said this before. I don't know. It's the truth. When I was in Bible school, this spirit of his son was sent forth into my heart, crying, Abba, Father. And at every juncture after that, when I doubted, because by looking at me, that I had come to a revelation of Christ or of the Father, I knew that I didn't send forth that spirit into my heart, crying, Abba, Father. The Father did that. And that was an anchor. But that anchor started working in me. And I said, one day, and I didn't just choose to do this. There's a whole lot more, but I'll just make it short. I'm going to raise up a Bible school. I'm a Bible school student at the time. I'm going to raise up a Bible school. And it's not going to be about Bible school. Because, you know, we got Christ for the nations. I started to say, for Christ's sake, for Christ for the nation's sake. You know, we got that place, and they have people from all over the world there. And there's no need to, you know, try to duplicate what they're doing. Well, we're not. This secretly is not a Bible school. Really? I never told you that, but it's not a Bible school. It was a place where what I had seen in the heart of the Son towards the Father and the heart of the Father for wanting sons in the image of Christ or for Jesus to get a bride, I didn't know much, but I knew enough that that was what was in their heart. I would grow from there, But I knew that was it, and my desire has always been, look, I don't care what your grades are, and you're going, yay, okay, but we'll flunk you and make you go through it again, but anyway, no, not really. But we'll, that's never been an issue to me. You know, it's not an issue to me. The only issue, here's what I believe. I believe you can flunk a bunch of grades and classes and stuff like that and actually come out with more Christ revealed in you than somebody who makes hundreds on every test. Do you believe that? That's all I care about. That's all I care about. And with the many students that we've had come through here and stuff, I mean, there have been some, everyone was convinced nothing would ever come of them. You know, they're not going to amount to anything. They can't handle this, or they're too dumb, or they're too much bad background or whatever. See, you know why that never bothered me? Because I was that in an Assembly of God Bible school and a hippie going to that school, and I was the first one there. Deb and all the other hippies followed later on. I was the first one there. And the teachers and instructors, trust me, they didn't like that. You know, well, how can this be of God? Well, that's the folly of God. That's the wisdom of God. He chooses the foolish things. Not that they're really foolish, but that to other people, they seem so not the one to get it. So I never have just gone, well, you know, we got a bad egg here, got a bad apple, lots of worms. Well, we got a lot of that. But does that matter? In the heart of God, does that matter? And I say it doesn't matter at all. I say the only thing that matters is Jesus' heart and the Father's heart. And we say, well, Jesus' heart for a bride. But see, he would, we've discussed this before, but he would never go, I want a bride. He would say, the Father wants sons, and he would live for it. And the Father would never say, I want sons. The Son would come down here and begin to work to bring that about through the cross. So, that's why I say there's a culture, there's a an environment, there's a reality among the Godhead that supersedes everything. But we live on this earth, and we live in circumstances, and we live, we're always fussing over something. My God, it's just ridiculous, you know? I was talking to somebody the other day. In fact, who's on this list? Gotta watch what I say here. I don't know if I could say it. I could say it in private to that person, but people have come to me. Let me just give you an example. I was the assistant pastor in a church, and there were people that were always, always having problems with the pastor. And it was just this and that and that. And here was the deal. For the most part, they were right. But they would come to me, and I was the assistant pastor. And my response every time was one thing. Look, we're gathered of God here not to get all of our stuff fixed or get everything blessed or whatever. We're gathered here to be conformed to the image of the crucified. That's what we're here for. And so you're having trouble with this person, but are you laying down your life? You know, it's not about them. Yes, it is. It's about them. No, it's not. If you want it to be about you and circumstances and people getting rid of other people, there are plenty of churches that can do that. There are. That's what they do. You know, well, let's weed out the bad seed. Their perception's usually wrong. The bad seed's usually the good seed. The good seed's the bad. Jesus is the proof of that. They hung him on a cross. And the good seed hung the bad seed on the cross. Okay. And so, you know, then this church is raised up, and I know I'm, you know, I'm not perfect. In fact, I'm weird, and I got a lot of strange things for a pastor. But I know one thing. I have stuck with when someone comes to me over a problem with someone else, I'm sorry, my first response is, I thought you were a son of God. I thought you wanted to be conformed to the image of Christ. And I'm not mean about it. I'm just telling you. I'm being a little more forceful here because I'm teaching. But, but it is true. I mean, the strength of that authority that this is what we're called. I know that here. This is it. See? So it's like, I'm not going to violate that. I don't know about you, but I am not going to drop down to that sort of a level and just make this about trying to clear up everybody's situation, you know, because of brother so-and-so or sister so-and-so. And let me tell you, if someone's having problems with brother so-and-so, it'll eventually move to sister so-and-so too. Because it's just a way of, you know, seeing things. And so, you know, and my own kids, they would come home from school and they would say, Dad, this teacher, they're doing this and they're doing that. Or this student, they're doing this and they're doing that. You know, and I'm sure, absolutely sure, probably all three of my girls probably have some area where some of this got brought up and probably have a problem and remember it to this day, that I didn't go deal with this somehow. I'm sure most people in the church that have come through have some example of that where I didn't deal with it. In that case, I only dealt with my own kids. They don't know Jesus. You do. You're the one responsible before God to lay down your life. For what? The unjust. The just for the unjust. That's who lays down their life. Well, I'm Justin, they're not. Well, then lay down your life. You know what I mean? I mean, you do not know how many times I've heard this over and over and over. And I've been consistent with my own kids and with people in the church and with people in Bible school, because this is what we're called to. And I'm going to stand before God one day to give an account. And I'd like for him to say, well done, you know, that you stuck with what I called you to do, and that place exists for that. And I've told her, Jim will know this, and Mike, I've said this from almost day one of our existence as New Creation Fellowship. The day that we leave the calling of God, the reason for what we exist, which is Christ and Him crucified, the day we leave that, God, I've prayed, God, take your hands off of us and end this thing. I have. And I meant it. And I still mean it with all my heart. If we're going to get out, and we're not there, and I'm not talking about anything going on right now or whatever. I'm just trying to make a point that if that happens, we have no, if we get off from the eternal plan of God relating to the heart of the Father and the heart of the Son, we have no reason to exist. Why fake it? Let's stop it. Go either find a happy church or let's all hit the bar. I don't care. You know? Well, I meant to go in there and preach and save them. That's what. So you got to add that in, or somebody goes, do you know what he said? So, anyway, so there's this thing, to whom be glory, are we in Ephesians 3 yet? Yeah, we already did that one. Unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus. How long? Throughout all ages, world without end. Or, as it said in Galatians, forever and ever, to whom be glory forever and ever, amen. So, this amen thing, so be it. You know, we say it all the time, but you know it means so be it, right? But it means so be it, not so do it. You know, it's a being thing, and if it hadn't become a being thing, then we'd just go, we're without end. I go, okay, it's over, I don't like this person. You know what I mean? It just doesn't last long because it's not a being thing. We can believe this. We can preach it. We can write about it. We can do everything that we do. And until it becomes a being thing, it's just another message. It's just another denomination. Even though, I mean, because, you know, you say, we're not a denomination. We're filled with people that came out of them. So we're interdenominational, which makes us special. All right, let's go to Philippians 4. Philippians 4 and two verses there. We're going to look at verse 19 and 20. Isn't this funny that this is Ephesians? The other one we read, the first one was Galatians. Now we're in Philippians. But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Now unto God and even our Father be glory forever and ever. Can I hear it? Amen. I'm sorry, I guess I wasn't saying it right. Amen. I'm from Texas. We amen that stuff. All right, so there it is again. But my God shall supply it according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. Okay, it's the Father doing this. And it's another verse that we attribute to Jesus, even though, you know, we've never really, and so we always picture, you know, Jesus with long hair, which I hope to get mine cut tomorrow, long hair and sandals and, you know, a robe. I started to say bell bottoms. I really did. A robe. That's my Jesus. So the Father supplies all your needs, not according to what you think your need is, but according to the riches of what's in Christ.
Hallelujah.
Bounce back. To whom, God the Father, be glory. You see how that, you know, you go, it's about the Father, and then, no, it's about Jesus. Whoa, he bounces it back, and it's to the Father again. You can't nail these guys down. They're always, it's always about giving the other glory. Well, I just want the glory. Well, tough. Not if you're going to mix with those fellas, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Not going to happen. Because their oneness is this Spirit. And that won't ever be broken. That's eternal. All right, let's go one more. 1 Peter 5. And isn't it fun that we're going to different books and even different writers, and we're finding similarities, almost some of it almost identical. And why? Why? Because universally, the first church understood these things, and we don't, because we have been flooded with man's concepts, and we never really took the time to just read the Bible and go, wait a minute, hold that. That doesn't say what my mind always thought it said. That's not even talking about the same person my mind was talking about. My mind was talking about Jesus, and that's about the Father. All right, so we're going to look at this 1 Peter 5, verse 10 and 11. But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that you have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle you. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Oh my God. This stuff throws our minds curves, because we have such a settled thing. In a certain sense, I'll just say it like this. In a certain sense, it's almost like the church really never has really known the Father. And in truth, they haven't until... that's right. Until the Son comes out of us crying, Abba, Father. It is. And that's why Jesus always said, no man knoweth the Father but the Son. Well, I beg to differ, Jesus. I'm a pastor, and I've been at it for 57 years. I know the Father. No, you don't. You only know him by the Son. If you're going to know the Father, only a son is going to know him. And it's the Son in you that even makes you a son of God by Christ.
Amen.
That's the only thing that works. So, but the God of all grace, oh, I thought that was Jesus, who hath called us unto his eternal glory. There is an eternal glory, not just an eternal benefit. Is there a difference between eternal benefits and eternal glory? Does that go counter to the way we think? That there's a glory. You want to really start getting into the glory part of that, just read John, 17. Yeah. And it's all about oneness. It's all about oneness. Father, that they may be one as we are one. Oh, how are y'all one? I and him and he and me. Even so might it be I and them and them in me. Good doctrine, but Jesus wasn't praying that the doctrine would be in us. He's praying that the reality, this is Jesus' prayer request that we can be involved in helping to answer. But we the devil doesn't have to come in and destroy the church. All he's got to do is just filter in a bunch of stuff that gets us slightly off, you know. Like I said, if the target's way down there and you've got a bow and arrow and you shoot and you're just that far off, by the time it gets down there, it's way off. So he just goes, here, just nudging it slightly off. And then by the time you get down the road, you think in terms of things that are not like that. And like I said, you know, how many Christians, how many believers walk through their day or their week or their month or their year and really think about the Father? Or really, you know, any particular thing happens between them, like a relationship. You know what I'm saying? Like, hey, you know, I mean, something going on. But it's like, you know, I know he's up there. He's my dad. He's looking out for me. I don't have to know what he's doing. I don't have to even think about him. I have faith. Really? Is that the relationship that the Father wanted? Yeah, this is exactly what I want. Just, you know. I don't want you around. This is a perfect relationship. No, he wants us with him. And he wants us of him. All right. So let's go back to Galatians chapter 1. Galatas capitulo 1. Verse 6. I marvel that you are so soon removed from him. Him who? Well, let's go back to verse 5. To whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. I marvel that you are so soon removed from him. Who's it talking about? The Father. How do we know that? Because that, yeah, that. But he goes on to say, I marvel that you're so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ. So it's the Father. Okay. Is it possible to be removed from him without denying the Father? No, here's what I mean. Is it possible that there could be millions of Christians on this planet that are removed from him in the sense of knowing him, knowing his heart, knowing what was the desire when he created everything that he would have, and therefore not really relating too much to the Father, certainly throwing that name in prayer or whatever, but not particularly picturing or thinking about the Father, and yet still be Christian? I marvel, Paul says. I marvel that you are removed from the Father. See, he didn't say, well, it's interesting. Interesting fact that you would be removed. He said, I marvel that you are removed from the Father in this way. And he's going to use the rest of the book to explain that, and he'll stick with that theme and bring it forth, and hopefully we're going to hit some of that. I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. And also notice that if you're removed from the Father, you're removed from a particular calling. I marvel that you are removed from him that called you into something. So I wrote down, because it says, I marvel that you're so soon removed from him who called you in the grace of Christ under another gospel. I wrote, they have not merely moved away from truth, but from him, whose heart was to draw us into himself and unto himself by Christ. Is that true? We're defenders of the truth. My Lord, we are defenders of the truth. What we need to do is have right doctrine. Really? Jesus said, if you knew me, you would know the doctrine. In other words, the goal is to know him, and that falls into order. But if you try knowing right doctrine without really knowing him or knowing the Father, you might have all your ducks in order, but Jesus, the Father is not after ducks in the image of Christ. Amen?
Yes.
He's not after having all your ducks in order. It's not that. It's like, well, at least I know, and I do believe that it's good. We must know the scriptures so that we can know the living word, okay? I believe that. I'm a firm believer in searching the scriptures. I'm sorry. I believe that with all my heart. But I'm not fooled. I'm not going, oh, I'm learning all the scriptures and I'm becoming spiritual. I'm looking for something.
Yes.
You know, you've heard, Jesus, John the Baptist says, I don't know who he is. But, the Father showed me that when he comes, the Spirit's going to come on him and da-da-da-da. So John is baptized, but he's taking him into water. Down, up. No Jesus. Next. Down, up. We go down, up. Oh, praise God, you got wet. I mean, if nothing more happened than that. Yeah, we go, it's a spiritual experience for me. It was, something, I don't know what, but it was very spiritual. Okay, I don't want to take away from your fun or your spiritual experience or your happiness. I do want to emphasize Christ.
Amen.
And John isn't just going, yes, another one, Brother Bob, mark that down. How many? And this is my ministry. And I'm called to this of God. Was he called to do that? Yes. But was there something greater behind it?
Yes.
But for us, it's like, well, I've got a ministry. So my ministry is to move that from over there. God's pleased. I got news for you. He's not as wrapped up in things as we think that he is. He is more wanting his son out of us. So that we can be sons of God by Christ. Well, and that's why we fight. This is my ministry. And your ministry is, your ministry is smaller. Mine's bigger than yours. See, trust me, I've measured many times, and mine is bigger than yours. So yours should bow down to mine and acknowledge that mine's of God. I'm pretty sure yours probably is too. But, and then it's like, so your ministry has this space right here, and then this other ministry comes in, they get a little corner. What are you doing in here? That you are trespassing on God's property. Now, do us all a favor before I have to kick you out to the glory of God. And let's not argue. Just acknowledge that I'm greater than you. Just acknowledge that my ministry is greater than you. That's all. There will be peace if you will just find your place below me. Or preferably away from me. And so then this one says, the one that's bigger says, people are saying you're sweeter than me. And I don't think so. It says right here, sweet tea. I'm sweet. I'm sweet. You can't. Even if it's way over here, it's over there looking. How many people are taking bites out of their hat? My God. See, it seems ridiculous with this, but it's the same thing. Only worse. It is totally ridiculous. But it's like when we put it here, it's ridiculous. But when we're doing it here, I'm standing up for the calling of God. And I'm standing for the truth as it is in Jesus while I violate the nature of Jesus.
good. What?
That I want to drink from this ministry for a while.
It sounds funny, it sounds, you know, ridiculous, whatever, but it's so true, it's so us, we're so pathetic, it's us. And, but, you know, you said we violate the Spirit of God, and I don't think we realize that. I never realized that this week I realized the Lord and His love and mercy show me how much I violate the Lord. In His body and His people, you know, thinking that it's for the glory of God,
right.
Because I deserve something, because I'm somebody, you know, Christ lives in me, and He does, but I take it like, you know, it's a big thing, and it's not, you know, and God is a being, so He wants to be in me, not do, and I was so ashamed of myself to see how much I violated the Lord and His Spirit. I never have seen it so clear to this week that He desires. He's just so there to lay down His life in any given moment. For Him, it's not a burden. It's not a something big. It's who He is. It's His being. And He wants to be there in me. And I violate that all the time. Man, I just praise the Lord. I feel bad and sorry for the thing I did, but I'm not sorry in that I realize that now I'm turning my heart to say, Lord, please help me to turn in every given moment so that I won't violate Your heart and Your Spirit and who You are and what You want to be in me. So thank you for sharing that.
Amen. Well, I mean, it could, I guess that's the degree He wants to share on that, not greater, because I mean, it can go way greater than that. And these, you know, these are things that the Spirit of God is trying to teach us, the difference between us for Christ and Christ in us. It's a big difference. And Christianity, you know, and I'm sorry, you know, I always say bad stuff about Christianity, but, you know, that's not Christ's body. You know, and I, as I said before, and this is always shocking to people, Jesus wasn't a Christian. He wasn't. He was God before there was anything. He went up thinking, oh, I pray to myself, dear Jesus, you know, all this junk. You know, it was one Spirit within the Godhead, and that's how they functioned. And so you don't see, you know, like they said, you know, I'm of Paul, I'm a da-da-da, I'm of this, I'm of that, and Paul's answer was, is Christ divided? There is no division within Him, and there's no division within the Godhead. But there is division within us, because, number one, we live on the earth. Number two, we're full of ourselves, and we love ourselves. We do. We love ourselves. That's what we fight for, you know. I have to fight for this, you know. If nobody's going to fight for me, then I have to claw them and bite into them, and I've seen all this junk in me. I've seen it all in me, and after a while, it just got so odious and ugly to me that I just couldn't live with it anymore. I just went, oh God, Father, You got to reveal Your Son in such a way that it's real. That's what I said. I kept saying that. I need the living Jesus. I don't need a revelation of a teaching. Because that there's no power in the teaching of Christ. The power is in Him. And it's in His life, and it's in His nature, and this is the way He is. So, if we live down here, and we're not supposed to, in Him we live and move and be instead of do or whatever. There should be realities that are true within them. Realities that are true in the Holy Spirit. Realities that are true in the Father. That are true in the Son. And yet they're all one, because the reality, the subject might be slightly different. This one wants sons. This one wants a bride in the image of Christ. But the spirit in which they work to bring that about is always the same. See, there is nothing more important. There's nothing worth fighting for. There's nothing more important than to have this life have us. What does it say in Galatians? But now, after you know God, rather are known of him because, you know. And that begins to work in us. And that begins to be real. But until that does, well, you know, someone took my this. Or someone did this. Or someone, you know, when they did this, that crossed a line. Okay. Crossed a line? I mean, come on. Let's think about that. Everybody turned on Jesus. Everybody, they were accusing him of stuff he would never do. They were accusing him of things that were not possible for him to do, if you will. And they all believed it. And they spread it. And until it became a mob mentality. And then they acted on it and they crucified him. And at no point is he going, you know, Peter, get that sword. Forget the ears, go for the throat. You know, come on, idiot. These people are going to kill me. Or Peter cuts his ear off and says, now that I have your ears. No. You know, mouth just means one ear, don't you? Not really. No, it doesn't. I remember, this is something that I said when I was in Bible school. Yeah, but that was Jesus. That was the Son of God. I said that. I looked at that and I went, you know, that's not me. I mean, I wish it was, but that's not me. That's Jesus. That's the Son of God. And the Holy Spirit very quietly said to me, who do you think lives in you? And it was like, oh my God, this is the Son of God. You know what I mean? I mean, it was an awakening to not expectations anymore, but to looking to the source. You know, because the other was like an excuse for me. Well, he's the Son of God. Of course he does that stuff. My Lord, if I was the Son of God, I'd do it. And he says, who do you think you are also? By Christ. So, all of this, you know, for Jesus, it's pretty cool to go through the Gospel of John. We went through chapter 6, skip 7, 8, all about the Father also, just like 6, skip 9, 10, all about the Father, just like skip 11, 12, all about the Father. Just get your phone and look at it. Just put in Father and you go, whoa, skip, whoa. And just see that he's, it makes me want to look at some of those scriptures right now because Jesus is constantly saying in those scriptures, I can do nothing of myself. What I see the Father doing, I'm over there with the Father. I'm not doing my thing. That's what he says. Stuff like, and he says it over and over and over again. What I hear my Father, that I speak. What I see my Father doing, I'm with you where you're at. And he'll say stuff like, it's not the word agenda, but he'll say, I don't have an agenda. It's really incredible. It's incredible. Maybe we'll look at some of those scriptures before this is over. But, I was recently in there and I was just going, ooh, You know, because it was so clear. It was so incredibly clear. You know, the place that I was at where the Holy Spirit was able to talk to me, thank God. But it's just clear. And I just went, look, this isn't what I thought it was at all. This is Jesus saying flat out over and over, guess what? I don't have an agenda. I'm here for the Father. Really? So in a very real sense, he was saying, I don't have a ministry. I was here for the Father. I mean, it's just powerful. I can't put it into words, but I was so just deeply affected to know how Jesus just so, it's like there's all this junk and clutter, and he just navigated it so easily with the way that he saw things and how clear it was. So it was like, when we go, get that out of here, or that's, you know, wrong, or, you know, I can't move on until, you know? And Jesus was just like, and they're bringing up all kind of stuff, and he's just shooting right down. And even though it's like over here and there, nothing was deterring him. Nothing stood in front of him and said, no, you can't lay down your life to bring forth what the Father wants. What shall I say, Father? Save me from this hour. He's there. He's there. The very thing that we would say, this is the biggest roadblock. He's going, this is, don't save me from this. This is why I'm here. This is what it's about. They're going to kill you, idiot. Great. The folly of God. What does it say? The word foolishness of God is, and it's used slightly different in all of them, but it's like moria, and different little parts to it. Same Greek word over and over, from which we get moron. Because we're the ones it's foolishness to. We're the ones that he's talking about. We think, well, this is foolishness to them. He's talking about us, because we can't handle this. We can't have this, and you know, well, here, this stuff, this is, you know, Randy's a moron if he thinks I'm going to be this way. Well, I'm a moron, you know? I am not offended by that at all. I'm not. For several reasons. One, I don't need, that's what the rest of, like, the next two chapters about. I don't need man's approval, Galatians. I don't need man's approval, you know. The Son was revealed in me. That's what he says. I mean, that's what it's really about. And he's not all wrapped up in everybody's this or that or whatever. He's doing the same thing Jesus. He's just navigating right through because he knows what the calling is. I was called by his grace to reveal his Son in me that I might preach the revealed Son, the Son that is in us, Christ in us, the hope of glory. That's what he calls the grace, the calling of grace. Doesn't call it salvation. Doesn't go there. He doesn't mention heaven or hell. He doesn't mention all of the things. He called me to save me so I wouldn't have to go to hell. All this stuff that we're so full of. And, you know, you're going, well, you're a mess because, you know, do you want to go to hell? I hope you go to hell, Randy. You know, so that you'll go, maybe this was important. I didn't say it wasn't not important. I said there's something greater. There's nothing greater than the Lord or the Father or the Spirit. There is nothing greater. And if we don't get that down, what was it? I saw on a show recently, the guy's dying, the young couple, and she's crying. And she had messed up, and that's what got him where he's wounded and possibly dying. And she's going, is this ruined us? Is this ruined us? And he says, well, I think we need to work on one another individually to make the us what it's supposed to be. That means that we're willing to be with Jesus and go through, and when I say go through, okay, go through, that's just the externals. Get rid of, you know, get rid of stuff. You know, it's like if everybody's in a boat and the boat's starting to sink because you got too much baggage. That's what happened with Jonah when he was in the boat. Let's get rid of the baggage. I know what the answer is. Let's just get rid of the baggage, you know? Bloop, 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 bloop. We still got problems, you know? I wonder where the problem lies. It's you. We're going to have to throw you out of the boat. So Jonah goes, okay, thy will be done. I will go out of the warmth of the boat, and I will go into the cold waters. Then a whale swallows you and takes you deeper and deeper and deeper. You know, however deep you thought you were, it's going to have to take you really deep and then have to vomit you out. And then he's ready to preach to Nineveh, you know. He's got seaweed all over him, covered with vomit. He's on the shore walking to Nineveh, and everybody's going, I repent! Repent, or the Lord's going to do to you what he's done to me. Yes, Lord! All right, let's quit, and we'll come back.